And then we'll move on to the next talk, which will be given by Dr. Alessandro Maiocchi from Bracco in Italy. And he will be talking about the latest advances in the use of nanoparticles for medical imaging.
Okay. Thank you for your presentation. And thank you also for all of you that are now here very early in the morning. Today, my talk will be a brief discussion about some pitfalls and some drawbacks that are around the application of imaging, medical imaging, particularly the field of nanomedicine, nanoparticles, and how imaging can be supported and integrated with this kind of technologies. So basically, medical imaging has a big, very big potential in many different applications in the patients in the patient treatments. So not only diagnosis, but more importantly, also in surgery, biopsy, guiding therapy, guiding imaging, or just searching for better therapy. Monitoring patients during therapy, and why not also some applications in the drug delivery concept, in which we would like to have some signals that comes out from our systems and related to the amount of drugs that is released into the target organ. Of course, some of these areas are more covered, are more developed than others, and particularly when we are looking with nano system, we still stay in a very early advancement. This is just to say that molecular and we get imaging, medical imaging should always be focalized on improvement of patient management. Otherwise, there is no sense to search for alternative applications, and particularly any kind of solution or any kind of new technology opportunity should also should always take in consideration the need for improved accuracy of diagnosis, at least, and to provide some new insight in patient stratification, in therapy selection, therapy monitoring, and patient follow-up, because otherwise it's not sustainable from a practical point of view. Generally, we use some products that we normally call contrast agents in order to improve selectivity and specificity, or in other words, to improve the information contents that is that are in our images, in order to have a lot of possible application. Quite recently, at least 10 years ago, a new concept appeared in medical imaging, which is the molecular imaging concept. So the idea to have a sort of visualization and quantification of biological process at a very thin level, that means cellular and molecular. This is a very interesting vision, but with some difficulties, particularly in the area of nanomedicine. Today, as you probably know, molecular imaging only exists in PET and SPECT application with small molecules. Now, how we can translate the molecular imaging in another field, particularly in a field of nanotechnologies or similar systems? Basically, the nanoparticle can offer the several advantages in principle. One of the most important recognized in the past is the possibility to have a sort of signal amplification in the process about the recognition of specific epitopes. This is particularly important for those imaging modalities for which there is a lack of sensitivity. We can talk about CT or MRI particularly, while the other ones listed here are quite sensitive or sensitive enough in order to have not this kind of need. But one important concept that is around imaging is that today the daily practice in clinics is for a very short or very shortly time consuming procedure. When we are looking for applications having a nanoside system as a contrast agent, we are looking for a different concept and a different practice, because we need an observation mainly related to late enhancement of an image and not an early one. So basically we have not necessarily some minutes or seconds of our procedures, but hours or days in order to wait for accumulation of a certain nanoside system. This is a typical description of how the accumulation of tissues can change, changing this, at least the size of our contrast agent. For sure, starting from the smaller one, it is quite close, very similar to the current contrast agent, is the red line in the second graph. You can see a certain amount of accumulation of signal in the tissue that is done not only from the amount of vessels in the tissue, but also from a certain amount of extravasation. During when we increase the dimension of the contrast agent, the extravasation is reduced depending on the size, and also the signal decrease. And the differences should be searched on the retention more than in the first part of the imaging procedure. Another important concept that is related to the molecular imaging is the active targeting. But this active targeting is not very simple to separate from the passive one, because the combination of extravasation that is a transport phenomenon and the specific recognition of an epitope is something that is not very simple to obtain, with one exception at least, which is the recognition of epitopes that are overexpressed on endothelial cells from the luminal site of the cell. And for this reason, we studied quite a lot a microsystem, which is a microbubble that recognizes specifically the so-called KDR receptor, which is a receptor quite well described in literature, even if with some pitfall around. With the idea to use angiogenesis as a marker for tumor stratification. So one of the interesting things that we faced with in the past was the lack of good antibodies for the evaluation of the distribution of KDR into the tissues. And there is a lot of literature around, and almost eight different antibodies that can be buy on the market. No one is working well enough in order to describe very well which is the distribution of this receptor in the tissues. Indeed, if you look at the protein atlas, description of KDR overexpression in tissue, this is wrong, because the KDR is expressed mainly or almost exclusively on endothelial cells and not in tumor cells, while you will see that is described in a different way. So we developed our specific monoclonal polyclonal antibody, really, in order to characterize better the distribution of this receptor in the tissue. And we acquired enough information to understand that KDR expression may be overexpressed in a reasonable high way in tissue that are based on that are malignant cancer with respect to healthy ones or benign lesion. And so we developed this system, microbubble, a phospholipid membrane with a gas inside for providing echogenicity. And also we added a specific recognition functionality, which is a heterodimer peptide. So are two different peptides recognizing two different epitopes of the same molecule. These peptides were selected using phage display, and in this way we obtain a very high affinity. With this kind of system we can recognize a tumor very well. So these are two different way to look at an ultrasound image. For the image in the, on the right, describe the contrast pulsed sequence. That means just to put to underline the presence of microbubble into the lesion, and also we can follow the kinetic of the signal into during the time. And this is a time not very long, so it is around 10 minutes of imaging. And we can see that microbubbles, of course, occupy all the blood volume into the lesion at the beginning. And then if they have some targeting properties, they can stay for a longer and in an higher signal, providing higher signal. But for sure, the differences that can should be translated into a clinical concept is at the end of the experiment and not at the beginning. So at the beginning, we have only profusion. At the end, we have the differentiation between the overexpression of the epitope. So we've done a lot of work basically using animal models, particularly Dunning prostate tumor model, just because in our time, in our ideas, it was important to look at this specific application. And we arrived at the end in humans. So we are now working in clinical studies, describing, looking at the prostate or expression of humans. And one thing that is important to understand is that difficulties to validate molecular imaging procedure in clinics, because there is a need of alignment of slices coming from imaging in vivo and slices coming from histopathological analysis. And matching this information is not very simple. It is a quite a long process, but is absolutely needed in order to reach a useful validation, a useful information for a practical, usage. And again, we can see that there are some differences patient by patient, lesion by lesion, with respect to overexpression of a KDR or YGFR, as we want to call him. And it should be understood in the meaning of, from a clinical point of view. So then we also used then some models for studying a nanoside system, specifically for as a contrast agent, with or without targeting functionalities. We use solid lipid nanoparticle as a basic platform. And we arrived to characterize the distribution, the way in which they are, the nanocell system can work, but particularly in order to understand which are the difficulties to translate a different information coming from an image with respect to what the radiologists are habit to know, to understand, and to interpret every day on every image. So this kind of distribution is complete of the signal is completely different from the current contrast agent. The same lesion with the current contrast agent on the market will be more or less in every pixel lightened by the contrast agent. In this case, there is a sort of inhomogeneous distribution that is related mainly to vascularization and permeability of the vessels, but not only, for sure also the resistance to the transport of nanosystems inside the tissue. So there are a lot of parameters that should be in some way taken into account and characterized, understood, and translated in a clinical meaning, even if we can also obtain some advantages in active targeting procedure, like in this case. Of course, one of the problems that we have with nano-sized system is the lack of accumulation in many kind of tumors in humans. This has been very well described. And what we need today is a tool for a stratification of lesion of patients in order to understand which could be the bioavailability of nano-sized system or a macromolecular system in order to understand if a certain therapy can be used or not. So we have developed one procedure based on the use of an albumin and a contrast agent that can interact with albumin and stay bounded to albumin for a certain period of time, not too much long, but long enough in order to understand the trafficking of albumin in a lesion, and using this as a surrogate parameter for understanding the permeability of nano-sized system, at least at the level of macromolecules like antibodies or something like that. And we use this this method also understanding the possibility to separate on this in this way different conditions and different tumors, and also arriving to separate, to discriminate responders to resistant tumors at a certain therapies that are based on macromolecules, in particular in this case antibodies. So this has been done just looking at the difference in permeability that tumors can have, and so the bioavailability of a macromolecule in the tissue that can do the difference. In this case, in this particular study, a combination of paclitaxel and an antibody was used. And interestingly, we observed a very specific effect of paclitaxel, which is the increase of permeability. So is the use of paclitaxel can improve the permeability of the tumor, and in this way can affect the overall efficacy of the therapy. Indeed, as it is described here, the combination of paclitaxel and the antibody is very effective, but the antibody alone is practically not working, or almost not working. And this is explained only in terms of improved permeability, at least at the level of our understanding today. So this is for another very important concept, that means that is related on the fact that sometimes we cannot change too much the properties of nano-sized system, but we can change the nature of the physiological or physiopathological state of a lesion, and so we can prepare a patient in order to be treated with a certain kind of therapies. So in this case, we use a pharmacological approach, but for sure we have many other ways to work in this way. So for example, just using hyperthermia, or using ultrasound, or using other external stimuli that can improve and restore at least the dynamics of fluids into the lesions, that are absolutely important and absolute need in order to have a high accumulation of drugs, nano-sized drug into to the tumor lesion, for example. So just to conclude, I would like to say that imaging is a very interesting field of application also for nano-SED systems, but there are some limitations today. With micro system, it seems to be more simple, and indeed we arrived also in clinics in this way, because the signal that we can retrieve from the images are more clear and can be better interpreted in all the phase of the kinetic of the signal. While when we use a smaller system, a combination of factor will occur, and we should understand how we can separate or deconvolve the aspecific versus aspecific information from an image, because at the end the signal that we retrieve is the sum of everything. So sensitivity and specificity are two things that can be improved using the well-designed system, but at the same time we have to take care about safety, because in the imaging field, safety is absolutely relevant. We cannot accept limitations derived, or we can say some toxicological issues coming from materials that we are using during an exams, because this is not appropriate, is not the same concept with respect to therapy. So I would like to conclude here, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for this very nice overview. We have time for one or two questions. Dan, please.
Thanks for quite a broad a number of applications, and also the fact that you're working in the clinic is of course very relevant. But there are many questions that pop up when I hear your 15 minutes presentation. And one is, you show individual examples and pictures. How much work is done in terms of full clinical studies or full diagnostic clinical studies with the approaches that you describe here?
We have some studies already running, still running. We studied a lot, and particularly the most important difficulties is related to the design of the whole procedure in order to become quantitative in vivo, because molecular imaging without quantification is irrelevant. So we have to learn how to translate these images in numbers, and this number should be correlated with the standard procedures that are based on histopathological analysis of the tissues. So we have to demonstrate that the information that we can retrieve from in vivo imaging are robust enough and accurate enough to shift and to use this information instead of histopathological analysis.
Just a short question. How stable is the KDA receptor expression in the prostate tissue? Because it may also depend on the inflammatory activity there, on the surrounding inflammatory reaction.
So basically, when we talk about biomarkers, it's always difficult to clarify very well the situation. But we made some studies, and we attempt to reach proof of concept on tissues just at the beginning. And what we learned at that time was that on average, we can say that there is clear separation between benign towards malignant tissues. Now, the concept is, and this is what we are looking for today, if it is possible to correlate KDR expression as we look at during our procedure with, for example, the Gleason score for a prostate cancer. So just to understand if we can substitute biopsy, for example, with just for monitoring the patients in order to understand if the aggressiveness of the tumor is a certain level or not, using ultrasound procedure instead of biopsy, just because biopsy in prostate is a very complex and not very nice procedure to receive.
Okay, so I think in the interest of time, we have to move on. Maybe the two of you can get in touch during coffee break. Thank you.